This program is being presented to you by the Heraeus International Winter School on Gravity and Light.
Welcome to the 14th lecture. This will be a rather brief lecture, and it's on matter. Now, on matter, one should rather give four or five lectures than one, and we can impossibly do the subject any justice. But we'll do what we will need in order to continue with what we're actually interested in mainly in the school. And so essentially there are two types of matter. That's not physical types, they're more like theoretical types of matter. And one type we call point matter. And the other one is field matter. And you know examples of both. So here you have a massive point particle. And here, for instance, you have the electromagnetic field. Now, what's the status of these two? Well, in the real world, none of the two exists because those are both classical matter types. And we will only look at classical matter in these lectures. That's the first thing. The second thing is, actually, from the point of view of general relativity, field matter is the fundamental type of matter, whereas point matter plays a big role in the phenomenology of general relativity. For instance, we already discussed what massive and massless point particles and so on do. So they play a role. But in principle, for instance, the massless ones, you could discuss them like you discuss the geometric optical limit of electromagnetic theory. You do geometrical optics, and then you talk about light rays and so on. Even in classical electrodynamics, it's the geometric optical limit gives rise to then maybe an action for light particles, although in the fundamental field theory, there's no such thing. So in a sense, the field matter is more fundamental from the point of view of general relativity, more fundamental from the GR point of view. For instance, it will be field matter that generates the curvature of space-time. So if we say matter curves space-time, we'll take field matter. Now you can always take point matter and make it into fake field matter, okay? There will be problems in the tutorials about that. So this is more like an academic distinction. Sometimes it's easier to express physical ideas here. Sometimes it's easier to write down equations here. But really, this is not like we're claiming there are two different types of matter in nature like these two. But it's more like emphasis is more on the field matter. Okay? And so this is more of a phenomenological importance. So if I wanted to be very pure, well, I would only talk about field matter and derive from their statements about the geometric optical limit. However, that seems overly academic. So we'll start with point matter. And as I said, this can only be a coarse overview of what one can say about matter. So our postulates P1 and P2 remember that was that massive particles always run such that at every local light cone the tangent vector lies within the cone, and massless particles run such that at every point the tangent vector lies on the boundary of the light cone at the point. Our postulates P1 and P2 already constrain the possible particle world lines. However, the question is, okay, how does a particular particle really move? And that's the same question you have in classical mechanics. What's actually the law of motion? Okay? And but what is their law of motion? What is their precise law of motion? Possibly in the presence of forces. Now, you know that in Newtonian mechanics you have this idea of, say, the gravitational force or other forces that act at a distance, right? So somewhere there's the origin of the force, the source of the force, and you have a particle here and it reacts to it, just like that. Now, in relativity, of course, it doesn't make any sense anymore. And the picture becomes much more of that there is a particle source somewhere, and that source sources a field, for instance, an electromagnetic field. Very roughly speaking, then the electromagnetic field propagates somewhere else, and only then can another particle coupling to the field feel it there. So really, we replace forces entirely by the field concept, that they are interaction fields, okay? And I give one example for that. But the more basic question is, what is the precise law of motion without the forces? So let's start with A, without external forces. Well, and that's essentially a postulate, which, however, later on will turn out to be not a postulate at all, but a consequence of the Einstein field equations. So we have the action of a massive particle world line is simply d lambda square root g v gamma gamma of lambda v gamma gamma of lambda. And the g is taken at each of these points. So it's just the length of the world line is the action, and there is the mass in front of it. And you say it doesn't matter whether I have the mass in front of it or not. If I write down the Euler-Lagrange equation, the mass will cancel out. Yes, but later on we will add interaction terms, and then the mass will be of relative importance. Okay, so this is already all that is to be said about this. You know that you can, instead of having the square root, you could leave out the square root and normalize the curve to geometric parameter that you require that this Lagrangian be 1 all the time. But we would certainly also require, with the condition that g gamma of lambda of t gamma of lambda, comma v gamma gamma of lambda, that this be greater than 0. So we certainly want curves to run such in this direction and not in this direction. This direction, the tangent vector would not lie in the cone. That's why we chose these half cones in the first place. So we want a future directed world line that is a stationary curve of this action. So whenever I write down an action, it's implied that I get the field equations as the Euler-Lagrange equations of this. Right? So dynamical law Euler-Lagrange equations of S massive. That's just it. We postulate this. Similarly, we have S massless gamma equals, now there are various ways to do this. We just do it in this way. V gamma lambda, V gamma gamma of lambda. It's just without the square root. And a slick way to do it is to introduce an additional Lagrange multiplier here. That's another function mu of lambda. And so you have to vary this action with respect to the gamma and with respect to the mu. And if you vary with respect to mu, the corresponding Euler-Lagrange equations just force you to have a null curve. Well, that's how you call that in the jargon. You have a curve whose tangent always lies on the boundary of the cone. Okay? And the variation with respect to gamma, that's the equations of motion for these massless particles. Now, why do we insist, well, we don't really insist, but a little, it's convenient to start from an action and to derive the equations of motion rather than writing down the equations of motion in the first place. And the biggest advantage of this is that we can add actions. So if you have a complicated system, you can add the actions. Yes?
Did you forget the square root?
No, I didn't. I didn't. So the point is, first of all, these curves cannot be parameterized by their time because time doesn't run along them, roughly speaking. Although that's a meaningless statement because time we only define for observers. Observers always had time-like curves. Okay, always had curves whose tangents are inside the cone. Okay, we didn't define time for these null curves. And this is the reason why it wouldn't serve us well, right? It's meaningless. And indeed, in this action, there is no square root. Okay, good. So reason for describing matter or equations of motion by actions is that composite systems have an action that is the sum of the actions of the parts of that system possibly including interaction terms, possibly including interaction terms. What's an interaction term? Example. Say you have an action for one particle and you have an action for another particle. They have nothing to do with each other. But now you want to describe how they interact. Then you need an interaction part that contains both of them in terms that are a product or something. Such if you do the variation of the total action, the equations for gamma get a contribution from there, and the equations from delta get a contribution from there too. And this way you get an interaction term. And of course the interaction terms are modeled such that what comes out is what you desire. It's just a convenient, tool. Now, we can look at the presence of external forces. External forces, or rather, and that's the point of view I advocated a minute ago, or rather, presence of fields to which a particle couples. And that's again language, jargon. It means there is an interaction term with the field. Yeah, an interaction between two particles, but I can have an interaction with the field. Actually, we'll never look at something like this. It's just to illustrate the concept. And the prime example is the following. You take a massive point particle, d lambda, m square root. All of this is as it used to be. V gamma, gamma of lambda, V gamma, gamma of lambda. And now you add a term, an interaction term, with an external field. So the field is assumed given. That's why it's called an external field. And say the field is a covector field A. So not finished there yet, where A is a covector field, so a 0, 1 tensor on space-time, e.g. the electromagnetic potential right? E.g. the electromagnetic potential. If it's a covector, what can it eat? A vector. What vector do I have? I have this vector. That's all it can do. And you might only look at particles with a certain charge Q. If Q is zero, you don't feel the field. It may be there, but you don't feel it.
The linearity of action composition of system is an implicit assumption?
That you can add these. No, it actually, there's actually no secret to it, because you have one big generating functional. If they have different curves, objects they depend on, of course variation with respect to this will not see this, variation with respect to that will not see that. So you can add them without harm and not lose information. Otherwise you would say, I need that action and that action. But you can add them without harm. So first of all, you may add them and you're not hit over the head with it. But then the idea is, if you then write a plus and then you can do the interaction term, now you say, oh, how do you know that you can add the interaction term too? The answer is because you will design the interaction term such that it produces precisely what you want. So the mystery about the action is a little bit too much, right? There is nothing deep in an action, really, is my claim. Of course, you can talk about then in quantum mechanics, the whole action counts, not only the stationary points, and there's something there and so on. But from a classical point of view, it's just a convenient device. Okay. So you have this action. Now the question is, with respect to what do I vary this? Well, the point is, this is still an action for the particle trajectory gamma, for a massive particle trajectory gamma. And well, we may somehow also write the A in here, the covector field, but maybe after a semicolon, because this one is considered fixed. I assume it's already given on my space-time, okay? I'm now at the moment not looking at how this is evolving or where this comes from. And so it's not, the action doesn't really depend on it in that sense. It's not supposed to be varied with respect to the A. Now let's see what this is and why we would couple it that way. Consider the Euler-Lagrange equations of this. Euler-Lagrange equations. Well, now we know that from this part, we already know what the Euler-Lagrange equations are. If I choose the right parameterization, we know from this part the Euler-Lagrange equations are this. Do you agree? And if this was all, then the Euler-Lagrange equations would be this if the Q was zero. That's what we did before. Then it's just a geodesic. Now we have this additional part, so we have to include, so we could call this an interaction already. So we have to include the Euler-Lagrange equations of this. So they're being added plus. So how does this go? Well, dl by d gamma dot. So I go to a chart, whatnot, m d by dxm minus dl by d gamma m in that chart. And that's, of course, just the L interaction. Here it's the L interaction with that field. So it's L interaction of the gamma, the gamma dot, and there's the A in it, but the A is just given, okay? So what are these additional terms? So if I, it's kind of interesting to look at that, dL by d gamma dot m, what's the L? L int equals, in the chart, it's Q, A in the chart, M, gamma in the chart, M dot. Agree? That, yes?
Sorry, the first derivative in the first part of the Euler-Lagrange, the D after D.
Ah, it's nonsense. Yeah, it's nonsense. Yes, thank you. Yeah, sorry. I was already in the field theory, but even that was just unsavably wrong. Thank you. Okay, so you do this derivative, and what do you get? That's very simple. So let's go with respect to A. So we can also say here we get the A. It's actually cleverer to to have the A still down. If you do this derivation, you end up with the A down, because with the metric you pulled it down, if you want. Okay? Yeah, I said you shouldn't do that. I know. It's good advice nevertheless. So this is Q times A x the eighth component. No, hang on. Yes, that's true. And then I have to calculate dl by d gamma m, no, a dot dot. So I have to take the dot of this. What is this? This is Q. This is just a constant. Now I have to derive this. This, of course, depends on the position along the world line. So I have d by dx m on the axa component times along the world line gamma dot m. Okay? That's the time derivative. And finally, I need the dl by d gamma a equals, well, the a depends on that, as we just saw. This is q times d by d x a. Yes, d by d x a x m gamma dot m, gamma m dot. Right? That's what this is. Now if you take this minus this, so you take this guy here as the star, then it follows that star equals, this is q times, I take the gamma dot m out, down x, and by miracle, you get d a d yeah, DAA in the X system by DXM minus DAM by DXA. But we know this, gentlemen. This is Q times F down A down M, gamma dot M, all in the X system. And this is the Faraday tensor. So what we get in total here, we get m nabla v gamma, can pull up the index if you want, equals, I take this to the other side, so I change sign, is minus q, I pull up the a index, I get f a m gamma m dot. Pardon me?
The top equation there are two different indices.
Here?
Yes, A down index and M down.
Thank you. Thank you. And I calculated the right ones. And this right-hand side, there's the E and the B in there. There's the velocity in there. This is the Lorentz force law. Lorentz force on a charged particle in an electromagnetic field. So the coupling that was just wiped out, it's all right. The coupling to the A field produces exactly what we want, the Lorentz force law. That is why this is the right coupling. Apart from the fact that it also satisfies the nice property that this guy here is reparametrization invariant, and this guy here is as well, because reparametrization here will cancel precisely against the change of measure here. So this whole thing is still reparametrization invariant. Okay. So this is how you, so if you now want to understand why this is really the Lorentz force law, you need to ask an observer. You need to extract the zero and the alpha components with respect to a particular observer. And you will have to resolve the summation convention with respect to a frame of a particular observer. And then you see the Lorentz force law.
What is the difference between power velocity, gamma and gamma dot?
None. This is all in the So the right-hand side here, well, this here too, because this is a component in the system, is all in the X system. But you could, of course, easily write this whole thing coordinate-free. So M V gamma equals minus Q. Then you take the F, you have an open slot, you apply it to the V gamma. Now the open slot can eat another vector, but that makes the whole thing a covector, right? Or covector field. And then you can lift the index by using the sharp inverse. And there you go. That's chart independent. Yes?
Why did you start with the index down on the left-hand side?
I start with the index down because if you really do the variation, you will arrive at... you will actually arrive at this. And only after you then, after you calculate this, you then do an overall multiplication of this on both sides with GAC in order to get the equation with an index up C. Yes, that's just the definition of that, yes. We did this calculation and then we had to pull up the metric here. Okay? Good. This is all not difficult. It's just to show how you deal with matter, coupled to forces, and so on and so on. Okay. So more interesting is second, field matter. Now, it's very difficult to give a definition of matter that's not overstating or understating what matter is. Because in fact we know there are, currently we believe, there are four types of matter in the standard model, right? Well, of interaction matter, and then there are a few Dirac fields around and so on. And but here we're talking about classical field theory, and so the definition is classical field matter. And once I'm there, I could actually say it's just Maxwell theory. Because really the only classical field theory we have out there in nature is Maxwell theory. What else? Okay? So therefore, as I said, it's very difficult to give an abstract definition that's not understating or overstating what matter is. But nevertheless, we in general relativity, we are prepared to consider classical field matter is any tensor field on space-time whose equations of motion derive from an action. Okay, I mean, this is really a very silly definition. It's just, if I talk about matter, field matter, I mean something like that. So example is, as I said, S. Maxwell. Now, here, now, this is not a curve. This is now a whole tensor field. And in the case of Maxwell theory, it's a 0-1 tensor field. So what's an action here? Well, then the action must be something like an integral over all of space-time, and now I'm pretending for simplicity that there is one chart, for simplicity, one chart covers all of M. Okay? If not, you have to do your partition of unity and da-da-da, we're not going to write this down. So you have an integral, you know you're on space-time, you can write the determinant of G. But because the G has signature plus, minus, 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 the determinant will always be negative. If you want to take the square root, you have to put a minus sign in front of it. That's the only adaptation you need to make compared to the Riemannian integration we did, right? So this is just in order to compensate for Lorentz signature, U to plus, minus, minus, minus signature, okay? And well, then for Maxwell, you have the FAB appears twice, FAB, FCD, and the indices are relayed by AC, GBD. And then you can have a 1/4 in front or what, okay? And that's the famous F mu nu action. Who of you has seen that? Right, now that's just a relativistic formulation. Now, because of this extra factor, it works on curved spacetime. You probably saw it with eta eta. The determinant of eta is -1, so this is 1, so you don't see this. But if you go to non-Lorentzian coordinates, right, you do any other transformations than Lorentz transformations, this term appears nevertheless. So we need to introduce it. So even in flat spacetime, it needs to be there if you're in a chart that's not the trivial chart, okay? So this is Maxwell theory on a curved spacetime. But now it's the curved spacetime metric that we assume as fixed for the time being. Fixed for the time being. So assume the spacetime with all its little cones and all of that is already given, okay? Yes?
Would be
a non-classical, yeah. Well, non-classical, you wouldn't, you could still write down these actions, but that the Euler-Lagrange equations of it wouldn't tell you what's going on. You would have to do some quantum field theory with that. That's what I mean. So classical refers not to non-relativistic, it refers to non-quantum. And in fact, as you know, not in this form, but Maxwell theory was written down before the advent of relativity. But it carries in it the relativity. Okay. So now, the Euler-Lagrange equations for this equations for fields works as follows. You've got to be very careful. Now, including this guy, all of this is the Lagrangian density L. Why density? Well, because this is a density. This is a space-time scalar because everything is contracted, but this makes it a Lagrangian density. And it's important that you carry this with you. So the equations of motion are dL by, okay, so you start with deriving with respect to the mth component. So we always do this in a chart, okay? Always do it in a chart. Then comes the minus the L. Now you go with respect to the derivatives of that, del S AM. And then you derive with respect to XS. Now this is for Lagrange, so 0 equals. So this is for Lagrangians that depend on the A. By the way, where's the A? I write here an A and here I write an F. Well, this F is nothing but a short form for, very important, del A, AB, and disymmetrized times 2, right? And you might wonder how you can act with a partial derivative on the A. Well, you know that you can act with a covariant derivative on it, and then you antisymmetrize, and you know that's the same, that you checked in the tutorials, that the gammas drop out, okay? So it's this thing. The F is just a short notation. The real degree of freedom of electrodynamics is not the E in the B field, it's the underlying potential. You must vary with respect to the potential. So in here, that's just the E's and the B's. Actually, this action here, this is E squared minus B squared, this part. If you vary it with respect to E and B, the answer would be E equals 0, B equals 0, right? That can't be it. The degrees of freedom with respect to which you have to vary is the potential. Now, these are the Euler-Lagrange equations. If the action depends on the A and possibly up to the first derivative of the A, which is the case here. If you have an action that depends on even more derivatives, this continues with alternating sign, plus, minus, plus. Now you get the double derivative d by dxs, d by dxt, right? d2l by d dt ds am, and so on. Okay? And of course, at some point when the Lagrangian no longer depends on the Lagrangian density, you can stop there. Okay, these are the Euler-Lagrange equations for fields. And in the concrete example, I'm not going to carry that out. It's a little bit stressful. After some calculation, you come to nabla m, or nabla d by dxm to be precise, f m a equals zero. So these are the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations. Now you wonder why inhomogeneous. Isn't that homogeneous? Well, but you could have the current J here, but you would also only have that current J here if this was coupled to a current. So if you had plus A acting on the current times Q. Or if it's a charge current, you don't need to Q. It's essentially what we wrote down before. It's essentially what we wrote down before. This makes the coupling to a current. Okay? And the current itself, for instance, if it comes from a point particle, could be exactly this. That's it, yes? That's right, that's right. I was a little bit sloppy with notation here. D by dxa like this, and here we declared the notation. Okay. So all of this fits nicely. The question is, if this, these are the Euler-Lagrange equations, where are the inhomogeneous Maxwell equations? Who knows? Yes?
If the D, the exterior derivative of this thing is zero.
Yes. So essentially, the idea that that you have the F given by this immediately implies that the del A FBC totally anti-symmetrized, and you checked as well that this thing is the same as this thing. Do you remember on the problem sheet that this is zero and these are the homogeneous Maxwell equations? Now again, if you want to compare with the Maxwell equations as they appear in Jackson on the first few pages, you go to a frame, to an observer frame, you extract in terms of E's and B's, and you'll get it. Okay? In flat spacetime. In curved spacetime, you get something maybe corrected. Okay, so that's Maxwell theory, and that's already the prototypical example, and really, as I said, in classical physics, it's the only example of a field theory that's realized in nature. Right? So you have other well-liked examples, other example well-liked by textbooks is L. Klein-Gordon. There you say that's just a scalar field. So that's a zero-zero tensor field. So how is that? Oh, that's already L. I want to write down the S of Klein-Gordon over the whole manifold and the same assumption that this exists, like that, square root of minus G. And there you have GAB del A phi. You know that suffices on a scalar, del B phi. And then you can have all possible kinds of extra terms, like, for instance, this one. Like, for instance, this one, okay, where you say it's a Klein-Gordon field of mass m. However, don't take it too seriously. I mean, the question is, what does that mean? Actually, this mass can only get a meaning then in quantum theory again. It's a scalar field, right? Well, in quantum theory, it could be a Higgs field or something like this. But in classical physics, we just don't have a fundamental scalar field. We don't see it. Okay? So this is actually the prime example. Now, why am I talking about matter in the first place? Well, I already told you, the Einstein equations have matter sources. So the curvature of space-time will be determined. Parts of the curvature of space-time will be determined by the matter contents of the space-time. So therefore, we need to talk about matter. So third is the energy-momentum tensor. of matter fields. Now I will give you a definition of the energy momentum tensor that will not fit the definition that you met in probably field theory classes, if you saw this. But it can be shown to coincide . But that's not easy, and that has only more or less recently been further clarified. It's been an issue of long debate, but anyway, I'm not going to in that. The prelude to this is that at some point we want to write down an action for the metric tensor itself, for the metric tensor field itself. Because so far, we always said, let's assume there's a smooth manifold, and it's equipped with some Lorentzian metric in a time orientation. And the question is, which Lorentzian metric should I choose? And the answer is, we will write down dynamical equations for the metric that need to be solved, and the solutions are the metric you should use. And the equations will be the Einstein equations, okay? And in order to obtain them, we will write down an action for the metric tensor field itself. But then, so this action, which we may call S-grav, like gravity action, that takes the metric, will be added to any as matter of whatever matter fields this depends on, an A, maybe a phi if you're courageous and so on, will be added to any as matter in order to describe the total system. So we will have an S total that contains, say, the metric and the Maxwell field, and that will be the gravitational action that gives you dynamics to the G, and we'll need to specify this. And there will be the S matter, for instance, S Maxwell, that has the A, and with the semicolon, it has also the G, because the G also appears in here. You remember? It pulls the indices on the F. Now, before we put the semicolon, because we said we only want to vary this action with respect to A, because we consider the G as given. You remember? But now, if we have an action for G, we need to vary the total action with respect to G. So the semicolon becomes a comma, meaning also the G can now be varied. We can vary with respect to the G. And we must, okay? So if we have something like this, we can vary with respect to the A, and then this will not be seen, and you just get Maxwell's equations, okay? So this is an example. But if you vary with respect to the G, you will get a contribution from this part, and you will get a contribution from that part, right? And the contribution from this first part will be called GAB. The variation with respect to G from here will carry two indices, because the G carries two indices. And it will carry two indices down. If I vary with respect to the G down, we'll do this in detail. That will be the contribution from there, and there will be a contribution from here if you vary with respect to G, because the G is in there. So the contribution from there will be called minus TAB. And we'll fix some factors here such that the contribution will finally be called minus 2 TAB, and that contribution will be called 1/16 pi G, and G is the Newton constant. Newton gravitational constant. So this is for those who want to get the factors right. That's the contribution from here, that's the contribution from there, and the whole thing ought to be zero. Now this will be a general feature that this action here
we will not change, because this is just what it is. So we'll always get this term, okay? And we will, however, consider situations where different matter is present. Now, it could be that you have a matter action that doesn't depend on the G. Those are so-called topological field theories. They do not depend on the G. They're rather exotic. They're very interesting from theoretical points of view. But in nature, again, if we talk about classical matter, this is anyway the only classical field matter we have. And it comes with the G. But also, you saw the Klein-Gordon field takes the G. It requires the G here. Okay? So all the matter we actually know in the standard model, for instance, if you want to consider all standard model matter also classically, if you're so adventurous, they all depend always of the G. So you very often, all the time, you have the situation, this term stays fixed, and you consider various matter actions. Well, it's very convenient once and for all to associate a matter action to this object here, which you just get by varying this guy with respect to G. Okay? And then you always get the same type of equation, namely GAB equals 8 pi G, that's the Newton constant, G Newton I should write, G Newton, TAB. You always get the same type of equation, which is called the Einstein equation. We still have to, tell you how this thing looks like, because I still have to tell you how this thing looks like. But the idea is, whatever matter we have, the variation of it with respect to the G is this object. That's the secret why we're interested in this object. And that object has a name, definition. If S, for any matter field, I write a capital phi, could be anything, G, matter, is a matter action, the so-called energy momentum tensor is TAB defined as 2, that's by convention, that's this 2, by you take out the density.
I have a question.
Yes? Yeah, that's true. That's true. That's true. So it's 1/2 here. And I put the 2 here, but that's of course a 1/2 in front. Okay. Sorry. Okay. It's this guy. It's just convention in order to make it coincide with the standard energy momentum tensor. True by this. Well, you need to vary with the action. You vary with respect to the metric, but we know how that works. I don't need to go through variational calculus. I know that I just start with L matter with respect to GAB minus L matter with respect to del S GAB. And this is again a D by DXS. I'm now really using this short form here. DS plus the higher derivatives and so on. Okay? And if I do the variation always with this sign here, I guess I need the minus here. Okay. So sign conventions are notoriously dangerous in this context because the L matter contains the G, for instance, here. So also the sign of the G goes in because what you want at the end, so this morning somebody gave me the hint that this should be called a Schrödinger minus. It's only after, at the end of the calculation, you measure, and then you see whether it's plus or minus, okay? So what you want, so choose all sign conventions. For instance, this last one, such that the T, which is here defined as a 2-0 tensor, but you could also define it as a, well, anyway, that epsilon 0, epsilon 0 is greater than 0. So if this is this eats two covectors, so it could eat the epsilon 0 covector associated with an observer frame. Observer frame is E, but epsilon is the unique dual frame. You take the zeroth one, and you always want this to be bigger than 0. Okay, this is positive energy. Okay, so you always want it like that. So be careful here. Okay, so this is the energy momentum tensor of that matter action, because that's the variation already expressed in terms of the Lagrangian density. Okay, and again, its role is that it appears on the right-hand side of the Einstein equations. Right. So example, for Maxwell, for S Maxwell, T, A, B down, and I'll pull the indices down with the metric, is F A M F B N, oh God, I hope that the signs are right, minus 1/4 F M N F M N up, if you contract with the metric, blah blah blah, G A B, or something of the type. I'm sorry, I think it's right. Okay, you calculate it, right? I mean, see, if I just exchange two indices here, it's already a different sign and so on. Well, calculate it. Okay, homework, check all signs in today's lecture. So this is the energy momentum tensor for Maxwell theory. It will depend from point to point, depending on how the electric and the magnetic field are. And then you have observer-dependent quantities like T E0 E0, will be E squared plus B squared, if you think in these fields, and that's the energy density. And or you think of T of E0 E alpha, that's I think something E cross B, if you pull the index, that's the momentum density. Okay, so you can extract these quantities from the energy momentum tensor. Pardon me?
Why don't we choose only the positive energy solution? If we have Klein-Gödel equation,
yes,
we often choose the negative ones and interpret them somehow.
Somehow. Well, I mean, if I have negative energy in the matter, then the system is unstable because the matter can suck up more and more and more energy, and the system is unstable. So that's why you don't want that,
so
right? Yes, so there are a whole number of conditions you could impose on an energy momentum tensor. So the thing is the following. Because we have only one type of matter classically there, what one tries to do is one tries to capture or to imagine what any future matter one might discover, what kind of energy momentum tensor it might have. Not in detail, but from its properties. So there is a whole list of different so-called energy conditions one can put on this guy. Strong energy condition, the dominant energy condition, dot, 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 dot. Okay? They're all made in order to somehow capture our idea of matter. But with just one example in the classical domain, it's a rather academic idea to give an abstract rule for which you have only one example to test it. Okay? So, and that should capture all the future matter. But for instance, in cosmology, so fact, one often does not specify the fundamental equations of motion or the fundamental action for some matter, but one is rather satisfied to assume certain properties or forms of the energy momentum tensor TAB. And the prime example we're also going to look at is in cosmology. in a homogeneous and isotropic universe, we'll talk more about this, these are symmetry conditions. There are 6 Killing vector fields eliminating the metric. In cosmology, one often considers a perfect fluid. The idea is that at large scales, the galaxies or the galaxy clusters, whatnot, in the universe, they form a perfect fluid that just flows. And if it flows, it has a tension vector field, 4 tension vector field U. And then a perfect fluid of pressure P and density rho is modeled by an energy momentum tensor TAB, which is rho plus P UA UB. So you use the components of the flow vector field. Minus, in our conventions, minus is correct, minus P GAB. Density rho, pressure P. And you say, I don't care what the fluid consists of, but it's a fluid with a certain pressure and a certain density, and there are of course arguments why it should take this form. That's not wrong. I mean, this is a perfect fluid. That's what we call a perfect fluid. But you see, one doesn't care about saying from what action does it come. Okay, I think it's in fact rather difficult to get this from an action. This is phenomenology. You say we just fill space-time with matter that has this property because that's our idea of how the contents of the universe at very, very large scale looks like. So In phenomenology, one plays these games in order to make progress in solving the Einstein's equations. You do not always start with a fundamental matter action and then go down. But what you can do, for instance, you can ask, what is a radiation fluid? What is a fluid of photons? Well, this is already a quantum mechanical term, but you know what I mean, of light particles, right? What's a fluid of photons? Well, you observe that if you take the Maxwell energy momentum tensor, I just wrote down before, and you contract its 2 indices, you will get 0. That was the reason for the 1/4 back there, because there was a metric with another metric, gives a dimension of space-time, the 4th cancels, and so on. Well, it wasn't the reason for that, but that came out because the action is like that, but because of this 1/4, you have this result. Now you can say, I mean, this is a very quick argument, one can make this more precise, you can say, aha, so if I now have a fluid, perfect fluid, AB, and should be a perfect fluid of such stuff that I know fundamentally, then please the perfect fluid that is a radiation fluid should satisfy the same. So I apply this to over there, so I get rho plus P UA UB GAB minus P GAB, GAB, right? And I should have said here that these U's, you see, these U's are normalized. And what do you get? They're normalized. This is 1. This is 4. So you get rho plus P minus 4P is 0. That is rho equals 3p. That's wrong. Oh, no, that's right, correct. So p is a third rho. And that's the equation of state, as one calls it. Equation of state for a radiation fluid. So you see, I had here the p and the q, but I need to somehow relate them. And that I must submit by hand. I have to say, what kind of fluid is this? I could also set P to 0, then I have dust. Just has a density, but no matter how dense it becomes, it doesn't develop pressure. So the late universe, where everything's very far away from each other, there's no interaction. That's like dust. The early universe, where there's radiation, that's radiation dominated, we'll come to that, the pressure is the higher the density is. Okay? So you can play these games with the energy momentum tensor, ignoring what particular solution you choose here. So I hope that this afternoon at 3 o'clock, if you don't mind, because I need to rest my voice, otherwise I hope it will fail, at 3 o'clock we could reconvene. Is that okay with the organization? Yes. Okay. So let's try to reconvene at 3 o'clock. In case my voice does not recover, we'll have an emergency plan. Thank you.